The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, yes. Every Friday we get together with Marcy Wheeler of emptywheel.net to try to dissect the events of the week finally ending. And boy, it's just been nonstop. And I'll tell you something. Yesterday might have been the most surreal day of all on so many fronts, between the Trump trial, the revelations about Samuel Alito. He's challenging Clarence Thomas to be the most corrupt member of the Supreme Court, but there's a lot of competition there, and so much more. So we turn to Marcy Wheeler. Say good morning. You're making it through the week okay?
Well, I was sort of offline yesterday through this surreality, so I had to suck it up this morning. And hello? Yeah. I think Sam Alito, for what it's worth, is more of a fascist, and Clarence Thomas is more corrupt.
But there you go.
They're peas in a pod. I mean, let's start with the good news.
Okay.
Clarence Thomas wrote an opinion this week, 7-2 opinion, upholding the financing of the CFPB, the Consumer Finance Protection Board. So good news is that the agency invented by Elizabeth Warren to protect consumers lives to fight another day. And it was Clarence Thomas who wrote the opinion.
Wow. That was surprising.
When you have something nice to say, say it. Now, Sam Alito was in the wrong in that. And we discovered that his wife, he's blaming his wife.
Yes, he is.
His wife put up a distress flag.
There it is.
Right after January 6th, because she says her neighbor put up a sign that said "fuck Trump," which is free speech.
Yes, it is. So he's blaming his wife, and he takes no responsibility. The fact that this thing flew outside of his house while the Supreme Court was hearing a case on elections, it's a distress sign, the upside down flag, but it was used by the Trumpers to stop the steal nonsense. And he knows that, or he should. He's a Supreme Court justice, right?
Well, he should know as a threshold level that when you make statements like that, when you get into a spat with your neighbor about whether someone is allowed to exercise their free speech and say, fuck Donald Trump in their front yard, then you sacrifice the apparent integrity, the perceived integrity of the entire court. And he's, you know, like, it's not like we thought he was unbiased at all.
No.
But now, you know, now we have a symbol of his bias and a symbol of his arrogance and a symbol of his refusal to adhere to basic norms. And that's where we are.
And I shouldn't be shocked by anything anymore, just knowing what's happened in this country in the last few years. But we have there seems to be no system of checks and balances that oversees the Supreme Court. There's supposed to be three co-equal branches of government, yet we've got major corruption at the court and nobody seemingly in any position to do anything about it.
Right. Well, who's going to do anything about it? It's a co-equal branch of government. And I'm more concerned that we have no checks on the terrorists in Congress. And I mean this quite seriously. Yesterday, the Republican members of Congress, the MAGATs, are serially, they are taking turns, not just in Congress, like Vivek Ramaswamy and Doug Burgum. Mm-hmm. They're also doing it.
Yes, they are.
And they're going to Trump's trial in New York, and they are serving as surrogates to attack Judge Merchant's daughter.
Yep.
Which is a violation of the gag order, but we just haven't gotten to the point where we've proven yet that Donald Trump was scripting them. Mike Johnson did it too.
Like, Mike Johnson did it too.
The Speaker of the House went up there and undermined rule of law in this country in service of a fraudster. I mean, no one doubts that he's a fraudster, but he's their fraudster, so they're going to go up and decide to attack rule of law.
Right. Now, to back up for those who, you know, aren't paying attention, and I think if they're not, they're not listening to this show, but that's okay. Trump has been complaining that there aren't throngs of his fans, his sycophants, out in New York outside of the courtroom where there's a whole holding area set up for just such people, and they're not showing up. So this week, finally, I guess the members of the Republican House caucus and a few others have got their marching orders, so they're showing up in his defense. He's calling them his surrogates, which is an interesting thing, since a surrogate suggests that he is directing their commentary. In fact, I think it was Lawrence O'Donnell on MSNBC who said that he noticed in the courtroom Donald Trump editing remarks that these people then went out and read to the cameras. You mentioned a threat, Marcy, and I think this is the threat, and it's in writing. Here's Matt Gaetz, who showed up yesterday, who posted a picture of him and his other colleagues standing behind the orange one with the message on the shit that he sent out, standing back and standing by, Mr. President. That is a threat. You want to explain how that is a threat?
Right. Remember, this is a reference. This is an allusion to the 2020, the first debate, September 29th, 2020. And Joe Biden taunted Donald Trump to disavow the Proud Boys.
Right.
And instead, Trump said, stand back and stand by.
That's right.
And the AP and HuffPo have good stories on this today, so go look for them. But effectively what happened is that triggered a great deal of new members joining the Proud Boys, because all of a sudden the president of the United States had endorsed this right-wing militia. And that was sort of the kickstart for the harmony between Trump and this militia leading up to the attack on Congress on January 6th. That line, by the way, is how prosecutors kicked off the Proud Boy leaders' sedition trial in last year. Mm-hmm. And prosecutors, if we ever get a January 6th case, want to use it at Donald Trump's trial. I think that if we ever do get that case, again, big if, prosecutors will show a far closer relationship between the Proud Boys and Donald Trump than we know. So Matt Gaetz, who's from Florida, who is associates with a bunch of these Proud Boys, who has visited the D.C. jail to visit these people, goes out and basically uses a terrorist slogan while they're all there to attack a judge's daughter, promising violence.
Yeah. Yeah, it's astounding. And the attack on the judge's daughter, first of all, I think the scientific term for what they're pushing is, wrong thing I have queued up. Bullshit was the little drop I was looking for. That, you know, first of all, they're alleging that this woman who is not a public figure is making millions off of her. I don't even know. What are they saying? Do we know? Do we understand what they're accusing her of? Raising money for Biden?
She's a consultant. And so they're saying that she's raising money for Biden.
And making millions in the process.
And now they're like Dan Goldman. They've got him into the conspiracy theory. I mean, it is. Understand the premise, because we don't talk about this enough. Every one of these claims is this claim that political involvement from any Democrat, disqualifies you for public life. Whereas, you know, Donald Trump, he's got one of his own appointees who is presiding over his case. Two of his appointees are presiding over Hunter Biden's case. Aileen Cannon is worse. She's still doing the Leonard Leo stuff. The notion that, like, Matt Gaetz is a member of Congress, shouldn't that disqualify him from weighing in on this legal case? I mean, and it really is this double standard. But it's not that the double standard is the problem, although it is a double standard. It's that any involvement in civic life as a Democrat, and they presume it. like these attacks always, I mean, they did the same thing with Jack Smith. They did the same thing with Judge Engoron. Mm-hmm. Any activity in public life as a Democrat, they want to disqualify you from public life. And, you know, one reason I'm emphasizing that is because this is where a Trump second term would be. Yes. This is where, when they talk about Project 25, what they mean is anybody who has, who is as part of their civic life, a Democrat.
Yeah.
And it, you know, and effectively, you know, that sets up a one party state. That sets up a state where to have any involvement in civic life, you at the very least can't be involved as a Democrat. And, you know, if you want an actual job in government, you have to be a loyal member of the MAGA party.
That's right.
So, yeah.
Yeah. And, and further to that, they have through, I think it's part of this Project 2025, vetting if you want to apply for a job in the next Trump administration, fill out this. And it includes basically a loyalty pledge that you are one of them. Yeah, you know, the old saying, it's okay if you're a Republican to break the law, to do all kinds of shady things. In this case, if you're a Democrat, to use Trump's words, you're an enemy of the people.
And that is what he has spent 8 years doing with America.
Yeah.
He is moving towards a one-party state. That is his intention. And that one party state will not even be based on any real ideology. The sole ideology will be Donald Trump.
Right. You know, now it's sad enough that these members of Congress have all taken it upon themselves to fly to New York when Congress is in session, by the way. Somebody like Lauren Boebert is being paid by her constituents to represent them, such as it is, in Congress. And instead, they missed votes yesterday and hearings to go there and, you know, do Donald Trump's bidding because he said he wants people there with him. By the way, Jeffrey Clark was among the sycophants in the courthouse yesterday, which is kind of scary.
You know, I think somebody smart, some Democrat involved in civic life, should file a Hatch Act complaint with DOJ, because spending that taxpayer money to go to go threaten a judge's daughter is absolutely a campaign act.
Right. I fully agree. And, you know, remember, there's a gag order on Trump. And that means he not only can he not say these things, he also can't direct others to say these things. Now, again, I mentioned Lawrence O'Donnell said he saw Trump furiously editing what appeared to be copy that they were going to go out and read. There's a little bit of video of what they did when they went out in front of the microphones. Let me see if I can't play this here. It's pretty interesting.
The judge inside, his daughter is making millions of dollars running against Donald Trump, raising money for Donald Trump's political opponents.
You've got relatives of the judge that are benefiting financially.
The only thing that's being done wrong is by this judge. His daughter's making money, raising money for Democrats.
The real bookkeeping that we need accounting of is Judge Merchant's own family member collecting millions of dollars as a Democratic operative.
The judge's own daughter is making millions of dollars doing online fundraising for Democrats.
I love how
they're using this trial as a hook.
Yes, right. Reading from a script.
Mike, are you wearing?
Reading from a script that it appears that Trump edited. They're all saying the same things. Never mind the fact that they're dressed alike, which is really creepy. I mean, how much further can this guy take it? It's obvious to us, but I guess, you know, in the law, you need actual proof that Trump directed them. How do we get proof?
Right. And I'm not. Yeah, that's the question. How do we get proof? And if we get proof, then Judge Merchant can jail Trump, you know?
Right. It's the whole thing is so disconcerting. Anyway, so the trial, since we're there now, it appears to be in its last week. I guess the defense got one over and showed that Michael Cohen is a liar, And they caught him in a lie or two yesterday. All right. I guess we wait and see. But let me ask you this, Marcy Wheeler. Even if Trump is convicted, and the case will likely go to the jury next week, what happens? They're not going to throw him in jail.
Yeah, we'll see. You know, we'll see. Like, it wouldn't be an immediate thing. There would be a sentencing a couple months out. It's not among the possibilities. And I don't think it's proven that Michael Cohen is a liar. I think what's proven, like, I don't know how yesterday's outburst from Todd Blanche will go over with the jury. On the reporting that I've seen, there were experienced lawyers who were like, that was weird. You only do that from a position of weakness. And there were other people who were like, oh, you know, that looks bad. There are still other people who understand that Trump is trying to put Michael Cohen on trial. Todd mm-hmm. Blanche called him the defense at one point,
yes,
I think.
Yes, he did twice. Yeah.
Devlin Barrett, as he always is wont to do, wrote a story headlined in the Washington Post describing Todd Blanche charging Michael Cohen. But again, that subtext is important for us to identify because Donald Trump has every intention of prosecuting anybody who testified against him.
Yeah.
And so when Todd Blanche is talking about Michael Cohen being the defendant, he's trying to treat him as a defendant. But, remember, Michael Cohen, when he flipped on Donald Trump, he was sent back to jail. He was left in jail with COVID while Paul Manafort, who was in a jail without any COVID, was removed to home detention. Michael Cohen starts to write a book. He's sent back to prison. Yeah. I mean, I don't think people really account for the degree to which it's already happening. The degree to which everyone's like, oh, in a second term, it'd be scary, scary, scary. And it's like, no, it already happened with Michael Cohen. It already happened with Peter Strzok. It already happened with Hunter Biden. It's going to happen with Cassidy Hutchinson. I guarantee you, it'll happen with Liz Cheney. They're going to go after all these people.
Right. And they already do. Look, there's a whole side story here, and it should be front and center, which are the threats being made against anyone who dares to question dear leader. I mean, you criticize Trump, you take your life in your hands.
Right. And it is intended to terrify people, and it's not going to terrify everyone. I mean, judges at least have some kind of protection. But what about these jurors? I mean, these jurors, we haven't heard from them, but they are all readily identifiable. And the amount of right-wing traffic that's going in and out of that courthouse. And
yep.
By the way, the members of Congress are using their cell phones in the courtroom.
Yep.
So, I think Judge Merchan has not, and maybe I can never tell. I mean, judges sometimes are like, the trouble that it would cause to do something about this disruption to the courtroom is more trouble than the disruption. And so, we'll see. We'll see what happens.
Yeah. Famous last words. We'll see what happens. And we just have to let it play out, I guess. Now, you wrote something, Todd Blanche, Trump's lead attorney, who, by the way, used to be a prosecutor, allegedly is a Democrat. I don't know why, number one, why he took the case. One would think maybe money, but Trump famously doesn't pay his lawyers, although I think he had to pay him up front. He brought up the Steele dossier yesterday with Cohen. What does that have to do with this?
It doesn't really. I mean, one of the things he was trying to do was go through Cohen's lies to Congress. Remember, among the things Cohen was prosecuted for was lying to Congress about whether or not, basically about the fact that he had called the Kremlin during the election, and he was lying to hide that fact from Congress. And Blanche, I think, was trying to insinuate something about the dossier. It's not really important, but I like talking about the dossier because I think the best reading of the dossier is that the allegations against Michael Cohen, which were the easiest to disprove, by the way, were actually placed there by Dmitry Peskov. We know that they were sourced to a woman who's working with Dmitry Peskov.
Mm-hmm.
And Dmitry Peskov is the one person in Russia we can be 100% certain knew that Michael Cohen and Donald Trump were hiding a call to the Kremlin to Dmitry Peskov. And so it's actually very tidy if once you understand that, that like Dmitry Peskov knew that Donald Trump and Michael Cohen were keeping a secret and committing crimes to keep a secret. And that showed up in the dossier, like something that kind of forced that issue showed up in the dossier. And you know, the rest is history. I think the panic around the dossier, I also wrote this week, by the way, that Paul Manafort, who after he left the campaign, because he left the campaign again, he was still working with Konstantin Kalimnik on carving up Ukraine. And he went to a meeting, this may have been in Spain, but he went to a meeting in the transition period and met with an Oleg Deripaska person. Now, Oleg Deripaska knew about the dossier project basically from the start, because he had paid Christopher Steele to collect on Paul Manafort before that. Wow. Like it's, I think people, Christopher Steele would object, I'm sure, but I think people should think of the dossier project as a continuation of something that Oleg Deripaska started.
Right.
And so Deripaska learned about it almost from the start, which makes it very easy to stuff it full of disinformation, especially if you've just asked Christopher Steele to collect on some, you know, like we've just given him a task, you know, who's getting asked the questions. So Paul Manafort in January 2017 goes to a meeting with Oleg Deripaska associate, comes back and tells Rens Priebus, you know, the way to discredit the Russian investigation is to focus on the dossier.
Uh-huh.
Well, you know, if Oleg Deripaska was the one filling it with disinformation, who's going to know that the dossier is going to end up being discredited? Oleg Deripaska comes back. We start focusing on the dossier rather than, for example, Mike Flynn. And that's where we are today. I mean, the dossier really is one of the most polarizing things in recent history. And, you know, after January 6th, there was this guy who went viral arguing that what justified January 6th was the dossier.
Wow.
And I'm like, you know, basically you're arguing that Russian disinformation, because you believed Russian disinformation, because you fell for Russian disinformation because the entire country was victimized by Russian disinformation, it justifies an attack on Congress. It justifies an attack within the country.
Right, right. And you also pointed out that yesterday marked 7 years since this headline. I just put up a photo of the Washington Post front page across the top. Trump reveals secret intelligence to Russians. You know, it seems like he does these things. This happened. And yet where is the reminders? Where are the reminders from the media that this is the kind of shit this guy did?
Well, that was Greg Miller posting it. So he did remind us of his scoop, and more power to him.
Yeah.
You know, it's not going to show up in a Maggie Haberman story. It's not going to show up in any of the coverage of Manafort. Like CNN did just as shitty a piece about basically all of Trump's pardons. Ironically, and I say this a lot, ironically, one of the people who's doing best coverage of Trump's pardon abuse is Amanda Carpenter, who used to be a solid right wing, you know, operative, a Ted Cruz operative.
Yeah.
And now she's doing very good work on the abuses of Donald Trump. You know, it's interesting about, can you go back to that newspaper?
Here it is.
A couple times in the last couple of weeks, I retweeted it. So yes, I'm Shitter, for those of you who have gotten out of Shitter. Who knew that a guy like this would cart 80 boxes full of classified documents to his beach resort?
Who knew?
And if you go down, I don't know when you did that. Is that a screen cap or live?
No, this is the actual, here.
Yeah, so 8,000, that's pretty viral.
8,000, yeah, 8, 000, that's a lot.
8,000 likes and 3,500 retweets.
Yep.
And in response, every time I talk about what actually happened with Trump stealing classified documents, I get overrun by the trolls, and they just cannot manage. Like, this is one area where the cognitive dissonance for them is particularly strong. I mean, yes, Julie Kelly, this propagandist, is out there telling false stories for them to believe, but, you know, it hurts them. It hurts them to say Donald Trump. I mean, like, Donald Trump shared Israeli intelligence with the Russians.
That's right.
Israeli intelligence on terrorists. Well, did Donald Trump sharing that get back to Iran? Did it get back to Hamas? These are the kinds of questions we should be asking.
Yep.
How much of the chaos in the Middle East right now? I mean, granted, you know, Bibi Netanyahu he's already cast his vote for Donald Trump.
Of course.
But how much of the chaos in the Middle East right now stems from stuff Donald Trump has done, like share classified intelligence with Russia that then they would share with Iran and Iran would give to Hamas? I don't know, but we should be asking those questions.
We should. And this is that. We remember, we saw the photos from the day in the Oval Office. We know when he shared that stuff. This doesn't even take into account the many, many, many secret, top secret classified documents that he stole when he left office and refused to give back, among them nuclear secrets.
Yeah, there is one charged nuclear document. Mm-hmm. And again, the trolls are like, no, there's no nuclear secrets. I'm like, right here. It's right document there. 19. Mm-hmm. And not only is it document 19, but we know it's a nuclear document because Trump keeps complaining that his Q clearance was cut off during the investigation. Clearance that you get under the presidential executive order. And that's almost all clearance, except under the Atomic Energy Act, there's a separate clearance called Q clearance, which is where QAnon comes from.
Oh.
And that Q clearance, the president doesn't have sole control over. So that document, one of the reasons Trump is really neurotic about that document is even if you believe his bullshit story about, you know, declassifying with his mind, that document, he couldn't declassify with his mind.
No.
So that document, like, he could be found guilty of that document alone. Now, there were also three other nuclear documents in the batch that he sent back in January of 2022. Those are not charged because the way in which the espionage works is there has to be an element of refusing to give a document back, which is one of the reasons why Rob Herb was never going to be able to charge Joe Biden, because Joe Biden was like, please take my classified documents back. Yeah. And there's evidence he did in real time back in 2017 when Rob Herb said that he stole them without evidence. But Donald Trump, I mean, this is what differentiates Donald Trump from Joe Biden is Joe Biden went out of his way and said, please take this. And you know what? He didn't have to. He was president at that point. He could have declassified all the records and then just stuck them back in a drawer and no one would be the wiser.
Right.
And instead, he went out of the way to say, please take these classified documents back. Went through a year of investigation. Whereas Donald Trump, the archives, please give the documents back. Please give the documents back. Please give it, for a year, they're like, please give the documents back. So finally he gives only he's corrupt as hell, but he's not even very competent. Like, had he given back 12 boxes or 24 boxes, it would not have been obvious that he hadn't given all of them away, because they knew either there were 12 or 20, 24. There were 80 or 90 or, close to 100, but they thought that there were 12 or 24. And Donald Trump knew that they thought there was 12 or 24. Donald Trump arbitrarily is like, I'm stopping at 15. So at that point, NARA's like, there must be more stuff there. And then they kept, and that's the point. Donald Trump, people kept asking, give him back, give him back, give him back. And he refused to give him back. And that's the crime. It's not taking the documents from the White House. It's refusing to
give
them back.
And lying about it and moving them. There's video or photos of them loading these boxes on a plane to go from Mar-a-Lago to Bedminster so that, I guess, to keep hiding them.
Those are actually 2021, so that's the year earlier.
Okay.
That's when he took his Iran document to go share with Mark Meadows's ghostwriters.
The whole thing, I was talking about this with my husband last night. This is the bad movie that could not get made, because if you walked into a Hollywood producer's office with a script that read what we've lived through for the last almost 8 years, no one would believe it. It's like, how did we get here? I know that's what we talked about last week.
I mean, I think people would believe it, but it would be people who know authoritarian, Ruth Ben, I'm going to butcher her name, I apologize. Yeah. She routinely says, this is what's going on. It's classic. All authoritarians do it. We know how they do it. We know they use this language. I'm going to butcher somebody else's name, Jennifer Maris, Merica or Mer. Mm-hmm. She also does really good analysis of authoritarian rhetoric. And I'll try and find it so that I don't butcher her name anyway. Anyway, that, you know, like people who know how authoritarianism works aren't surprised. They've seen this script before. Right. What's okay? So it's Jennifer Mercieca.
Okay, I have no idea.
Say Mercieca. Mercieca. I don't know. And she follow her on Twitter if you're unfortunate enough to still be on Twitter. Right. But she writes really wise stuff about the rhetoric that he uses, and I think more people should watch her as well.
You know, you brought up, you mentioned Maggie Haberman earlier. Well, she was invoked this week. Her name came up while Michael Cohen was testifying, and she was invoked in text messages. Apparently, she and Katie Tour as kind of Trump stenographers. But she got it from both ends this week, Maggie, deservedly so, I'm guessing, or I believe.
Yeah, I mean, I want to be very clear about Maggie Haberman. Maggie is a really hard worker. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to take that away from her.
Right.
Right. But she has... let's go back to Judy Miller, her predecessor at the New York Times. Yeah. Judy Miller, also incredibly hard worker. But there are people like Judy Miller and Maggie Haberman whose momentum is very easy to manipulate. And this is not the first time. The texts between her and Michael Cohen about her writing a favorable story about the recording that Michael Cohen was caught with, and then Donald Trump wrote, you know, came out and said, oh my God, this horrible story. And Donald Trump has used that as if people should be focusing on how Donald Trump knew that the Maggie Haberman story was seeded by him, because Donald Trump's reaction to it is actually more instructive than that Michael Cohen reached out to Maggie Haberman. But there are moments throughout all legal documents. Remember, there was the one where Eric Hirschman was leaking details of Cassidy Hutchinson's testimony to Maggie Haberman. There's this moment I absolutely love from April 2016, where Roger Stone goes apeshit and screams at Rick Gates because there is an article in the New York Times about foreign policy decisions that Trump is going to, about a speech that Trump is going to make on foreign policy. And Rick Gates says to Roger Stone, the rat fucker, don't you remember last night you told me, or you introduced me to Maggie, or you told me? And then Rick Gates says, I leaked this to Maggie as a way to get it to you.
Whoa.
So Maggie, they, you know, and this is years ago, they give it to me. I mean, and people, I think journalists don't like to be confronted by the degree to which people that they view as hardworking, great access journalists are very easy to manipulate, particularly for somebody like Donald Trump, who's been doing this for decades, knows Maggie super well. There's another moment, Rick Gates prosecutors in 2019, after the New York Times writes a story that basically says Oleg Deripaska wasn't getting the polling data, mm-hmm. which was 100% wrong. Like Oleg Deripaska was getting, not only was Oleg Deripaska getting the polling data, but the document they claimed to be writing about made it clear that it referred to Oleg Deripaska getting the polling data. But they came out and they said, we've made a correction. Oleg Deripaska didn't get the polling data. At the time that happened, Bill Barr was basically being confirmed in the Senate.
Mm-hmm.
So Bill Barr was about to take over, and Rick Gates's story starts to revert to what it was when they were still catching him in lies routinely. So he was trying to soften at the moment where Robert Mueller was getting this headline about Paul Manafort, whether wittingly or not, shared campaign strategy with Oleg Deripaska, who was really the centrally involved in this attack on US democracy, rather than having that be the headline. This New York Times story via whatever means, Ken Vogel's also on the story,
of course.
I'm not going to blame it all on Maggie. But, you know, by whatever means, all of a sudden, the New York Times is affirmatively disinforming people about Oleg Deripaska's role. And at that time, prosecutors are like, hey, Rick, you still talking to the New York Times? You know, and it's clear what they're going at is he's, you know, she comes up not infrequently. When you cover these cases, she comes up not infrequently. And she gets very angry all the time. Like, oh, you don't know anything about my sourcing. I'm like, I'm not talking about your sourcing. I'm talking about how your sources talk about you.
Yes. Right.
And you need to account for that. Like, if your sources believe you're an easy mark for them, and they do, or at least they say they do, if your sources routinely say you're going to do a puff piece for them. I mean, remember, it wasn't Eric Hirschman. It was Stephen Passantino said, oh, Maggie's friendly to us. Maggie won't hurt us. You know, it's like they among themselves, this may have changed in recent years, but they among themselves until at least no more than 3 years ago. I mean, as recently as 2021, 2022, as recently as 2022, they still viewed Maggie as somebody that was easy to manipulate to get out the, and I call it a limited hangout, to get out the limited hangout. She's not the only one on this story, but in the days after the search of Mar-a-Lago, there was this line from Donald Trump's people saying, oh, he put a lock on the door and so it was okay. He was cooperative because he put a lock on the door. And, you know, from the start, I'm like, are you guys fucking kidding me? I mean, like, that's obviously bullshit. And I can tell you why it's bullshit based on the standards under which you store classified documents. There's no chance that DOJ would view putting a new lock on the door.
Right. That didn't turn it into a skiff.
And that's a really good example of a story that made it to the New York Times that was obviously a limited hangout, obviously a pitch of something that was regarded in real time as this great exclusive, but it was exclusive access to bullshit.
Right. Now Maggie is the one credited for breaking the big story that Donald Trump sleeps through court every day and got his ire. Do you think there's, I mean, you know, she's got it from all ends this week, deservedly so, certainly from you know, people concerned that the media is complicit with covering up for Trump. I feel like the stuff that Trump is criticizing her for is kind of show. It's not, but I could be wrong. Maybe it's just what I'm reading into it. She's taken.
Look, I mean, I look, and again, I want to emphasize, I recognize the woman is a hard worker.
She is.
But she is still, and always has been, cashing in on her long-term access to Donald Trump.
Mm-hmm.
What we are not seeing is like, here are the new sources that I've made from scratch. Here is my reporting on people that I'm genuinely objective to, that I am genuinely detached from. And so, you know, that would be a better measure of her reporting than what we see now, which is you can't like, New York Times will never do this because she makes them a lot, or she gives them credibility of a certain kind. And she also probably, you know, like New York Times isn't bitching that Donald Trump won't give them an exclusive interview because they have these Trump whisperers embedded with Trump's people.
Right.
And so they don't need it. You know, they've got this economy with Donald Trump. They don't need to beg like they are with Joe Biden for scraps when Joe Biden has just given those scraps to ABC and CNN.
Right.
But I just think, you know, New York Times likes to brag about its own objectivity. And whether Maggie thinks she has a contentious relationship with Donald Trump or not, it doesn't matter because at this point she is part of his ecosystem.
Yes.
And so you can't break, it's not objectivity. You know, she may think she's a hard journalist for him, but it's we're seeing a 15, 20 year relationship, you know.
Yeah,
whatever.
The benefits to Maggie Haberman of that relationship are paying off with her access. And in so many ways, it's all about access with a lot of these journalists. And they write things that I think are complimentary towards him because they don't want to lose access. Anyway, Marcy Wheeler's with us as she is every Friday morning. Or Friday, we tape in the morning. We're taping earlier than usual today because I want to hit the road in a couple of hours to go unplug and enjoy some music up in the mountains of Arizona, which I can't wait. It's supposed to be, today is supposed to officially hit 100 here in the Phoenix area.
Welcome to Arizona,
yes,
Nicole.
I know. It's the beginning of the oppressive heat season. But up where I'm going in Prescott, it's supposed to be in the 80s. So I got that going for me. And Michael Franti
music.
Well,
it's quite warm here, which means it's in the 70s.
Oh, wow. Is it humid, too?
It is today because it was raining. Yeah. Yesterday, it was stunning. I've got Masaccio from my site, who writes occasional columns at my site. He and his spouse are actually here.
Oh, nice.
And so we got this amazing weather yesterday. And I'm like, guys,
enjoy it.
We're going to walk. You may not have the intention to go walk, but we're going to walk because we may not get this good weather down the road.
Right. So, sorry, I just have to ask, has Springsteen taken over the nation of Ireland this week? Have you heard that he's there?
Well, he was in Cork yesterday. Right? Was he in Cork yesterday? Yeah. Some coverage,
All right, just making sure he's getting the coverage he's due. You know, I got to do my my lobbying for Bruce Springsteen. I'm seeing pictures of him in various pubs and stuff throughout Ireland, so there's that. Reading emptywheel.net this week, I think the person whose name was invoked more than anyone else's is David Weiss. And that's not a name that we're reading widely or hearing about on cable news, but you're telling us about him. He's the guy, the special counsel on the Hunter Biden case. Is that the right title for him? Is that?
Yep. Yeah, just like Jack Smith. I mean, he got to be special counsel because he was going to go chase Russian disinformation. And he gets very cross when you say, well, guess what? You were chasing Russian disinformation and you've not come clean about it. you know, I'm cataloging the days leading up to what will be two quick trials in a row of Hunter Biden. His attorney is like, I don't have time to prepare for this. You've got two trials basically back to back, which is really, you know, stunningly difficult. And the second trial really was only indicted 5 months ago. On top of which there's a report in Politico that Kevin Morris, who's been bankrolling all of this, is running out of money. So they're having, I mean, that there are a number of reasons. There's what Abby Lowell has described as the difficulty in getting expert witnesses, which is that they're getting threats. Did we back to that again?
Yes.
They're getting threats. And
getting
that
threats.
If they're from a larger association, their associations don't want to be associated with this controversial case. Again, this is like Hunter Biden has been made toxic by the Republican Party, and he's the one going on trial as a result. And then they're out of money. So they can't, you know, they can't pay expert witnesses. They're having to, you know, I'm sure the expert witnesses are the same that they are with Donald Trump. You have to pay in advance because we know you're broke, or we know you won't pay. So it's, he's in a world of hurt. People have to understand. And it's not just like, I wrote a post yesterday about the exhibit list that David Weiss is submitting in the tax case. And he wants to present basically James Comer's wet dream in the tax case. James Comer's wet dream has nothing to do with the tax case, but they, you know, and what's going to happen is that judge, independent of Hunter Biden, has this reputation of giving prosecutors whatever they want. So I'm not saying he's biased against Hunter Biden. I'm saying he's biased against defendants. That's not uncommon. So I'm not saying that, you know, this is because he's a Trump appointee it's because he's a judge and he's a hard ass against defendants. And Hunter Biden happens to be the defendant here, but he tends to give prosecutors what they want. And it'll be interesting to see whether he lets these documents in that one of them is a version of the 10 for the big guy.
Mm-hmm.
The Tony Bobulinski email, which Hunter Biden didn't write. Like, he received it. He responded with something else. He responded by saying, we need to do X, Y, and Z. We need to do X, Y, and Z. So it wasn't like he said, oh yeah, let's give my dad 10%. He said, no, these are the concerns I have about this deal. And he subsequently left the deal in part. Why? Because he was worried about Tony Bobulinski's ties to Victor Vekselberg, to this Russian oligarch. Another thing they want to put in is an email between Eric Schwerin and Vadim Pozharsky, the guy that he mostly worked with at Burisma. And basically, Hunter setting up a PR/lobbying firm for Burisma, which was the context that Eric Schwerin and Hunter had. It wasn't like, you know, it was like, at this point, this is just normal DC. But one of the, it's interesting. There are many reasons it's interesting that David Weiss is doing this. One is because if he really wanted to charge this case and argue that Hunter Biden was illegally selling influence to his father and to Tony Blinken and so on. Like, he's got two emails from Tony Blinken in there. I'm like, great. If you were going to submit emails from Tony Blinken, let's call the Secretary of State to testify.
Right.
And the Secretary of State can testify about how Hunter Biden, like, there are times in the laptop, not the emails that David Weiss is trying to enter into the record, where Hunter Biden's like, no, we can't do this. I refuse to lobby Tony Blinken on this position you want at the UN. I won't, like, I have my lines about lobbying and I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do anything that would require me registering for FARA because I'm not going to, that's not, you know, yes, he was selling on dad's name, but, and yes, people were willing to give him a shit ton of money thinking that that access would help them. It never helped them.
Right.
You know?
Right. Like, no, it didn't. But, you know.
Do you know what led to Vadim Pozharsky or what led to Mikola Zlochevsky to stop being investigated? Because he was being investigated by DOJ, if you can believe Chuck Grassley. You know what brought that about?
No.
Bill Barr. That was shut down under Bill Barr's DOJ in December of 2019. And we're supposed to believe that Hunter Biden brought that about?
Right. You know, and the absurdity of it all, where Hunter Biden never worked a day in the Biden administration. He's not connected there. The proof they're showing is questionable at best. But then you have the Trump spawn who are profiting directly off of and did their dad's time in the White House. Ivanka Trump with her $2 billion in, or however many, in patents from China, to Jared getting billions of dollars from the Saudis to pay off his debt on 666.
And Trump getting out, we don't know how much, for these golf tournaments.
Oh my God. Right.
And I mean, Trump is, we do not know, voters do not know if Trump is an agent of a foreign power, meaning the Saudis.
Right.
We don't know, because
right.
We don't know. There's no transparency on that golf deal. There was a hearing yesterday where Ron Wyden, it was about election interference, and Ron Wyden raised something that was in the financial records in the Engoron case, which is Trump said, I can't have overvalued any of my buildings because if it comes down to it, I can always get the Saudis to pay whatever I ask them.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that doesn't get enough attention. So no. Ron Wyden raised that. He's like, does that raise foreign influence questions? You know, that the Saudis have guaranteed that they will bail him out of any kind of financial woes they have. It's a good question. And then you've got these Russian people who are funding Truth Social, right? Like, anyway.
But so we haven't even talked about in the last couple of weeks what's happened with the Truth Social stock. Has it zeroed out to nothing as of yet?
No, it's stable. It has stabilized a bit, but there's still, like, their auditor has been declared a fraud, basically. And so there's still quite a bit of turmoil there. It's just people are going to stay, a certain number of people, and it's probably at this point institutional investors and also MAGATs who will stay in because they want Donald Trump to be president. And if he, you know, they want Donald Trump to be president.
Yeah.
And if he is, then having his stock will be that price of loyalty.
Yeah. Just everything that's going on is so... I need a weekend. I need more than a weekend away. It's hard to digest this. I don't know if you saw this exchange. There was a hearing, I believe, it was in the House Oversight Committee yesterday.
The Jasmine Crockett.
Jasmine Crockett and Marge. Did you see this exchange?
I did. Yeah, Jasmine Crockett, Marge, AOC. And AOC. I'm not sure who the later woman was, whether it was Luna or was it Gilbert.
I don't know, but I've got it, if you don't mind.
No, let's play it.
Let's play it.
These people are fucking nuts.
that's the technical term for it. Yes, they are.
This committee are employing Judge Mershon's daughter.
This is Marge. There you go.
please tell me what that has to do with Merrick Garland.
That's Jasmine Crockett. Is she a porn
star? Oh, Goldman. That's right. He's advising. Okay.
He's advising who? What? Do you know what we're here for? You know we're here about AG.
I don't think you know what you're here for.
Well, you the one talking about. I
think your fake eyelashes are messing up.
No, ain't nothing.
Hold on. Order,
Mr. Chairman.
That's beneath even you.
Beneath
even you.
I do have a point of order, and I would like to move to take down Ms. Green's words. That is absolutely unacceptable. How dare you attack the physical appearance of another person?
Are your feelings hurt?
Her words down. Oh, girl, baby girl.
Oh, really?
Don't even play.
Baby girl?
We are going to move, and we're going to take your words down.
I second that motion.
So who will have to pay us? Okay. Ms. Green agrees to strike her words.
I believe she needs to apologize. No.
Perry, okay, hold on. Then after Mr. Perry's going to be recognized, then Ms. Green.
I'm not apologizing.
Well, then
okay, reserve the right to object.
Perry, I am not apologizing.
Now let's go. Come on, guys.
Why don't you debate me?
Mr. Chairman, the minority.
It's pretty self-evident.
You're not. You don't have enough intelligence.
Chair recognizes Mr. Perry.
Okay, move to strike
I'd
the.
Like to strike
I move
to strike
the ladies'
well.
Words.
I would like to strike
the ladies' words again.
That's two requests to strike.
Oh, they cannot take the words.
There's another motion to strike her words again. Please right, okay, get your members under
control. Here's the correct apology, Ms. Green. Do you agree to unanimous consent to strike your words?
I repeat again for the second time. Yes, I'll strike my words, but I'm not apologizing.
Without objection.
Mr. Chair, point of order.
Look at Jamie Raskin. He's just like, what the fuck?
It's me.
Ms. Crockett.
I'm just curious, just to better understand your ruling, if someone on this committee then starts talking about somebody's bleach blonde, bad built butch body, that would not be engaging in personalities, correct?
Oh my God.
Chairman, I make a motion to strike those words.
I don't think that's a parliament.
I'm trying to find clarification on what quality.
Chairman, motion to strike those words.
I have no idea what you just said.
We're not gonna do this. Look, you guys earlier literally just
voted to do it.
Order.
I'm trying to get clarification.
Look, it, calm down.
No, because this is what y'all do. So I'm trying to get clarification.
Ms. Crockett, you're not recognized. Ms. Crockett.
I can't hear you with your yelling.
You don't want me
calm
to
down.
Be, no.
Can you please calm
don't
down?
Don't tell me to calm down.
Calm down.
Because y'all
please
talk noise,
down.
And then you
you're
can't
out of
take
control.
Because if I,
look,
come,
chairman,
if I come and talk shit about
break
her,
break
y'all going to have a problem.
Chairman, Mr. Chairman.
All right, Chair, okay. Order. Chair now recognize.
Oh, my God. I feel like I'm watching the House of Commons. I was waiting for them to get up and come to blows. What the hell is going on?
Well, I mean, Marge has never adhered to congressional norms.
No.
And that's part of the problem is, like, Comer likes to pretend that he has some control over his committee. Because he knows this looks like shit to him. And Jamie Raskin is very, very good at kind of saying, well, here's what you need to do, Congressman. And but, you know, Marge has never adhered to this. She attacks a black woman.
Yep.
And then a Latina comes in and the baby girl, which I love.
The baby girl.
And then Marge now realizes she has to assert her power over this black woman and this Latina. Otherwise, she's going to look weak in front of her mob, basically. And so, you know, this is the vision for America that Donald Trump has. Ugh. This is the vision for America that Donald Trump has, which is that rather than doing your job, because remember, Marge had already gone to New York to waste our tax money.
That's right.
To threaten a judge's daughter. But it's not to do your job. It's to try and inflict a system of power where black women and Latinas are silenced.
Right.
And can be mocked or can be, you know, Jasmine Crockett is becoming, and for those who don't know her, Who am I kidding? All your watchers.
They know
of
her.
Of course, no Jasmine Crockett. Yes. But I think she's becoming a superstar in the same mm-hmm. way that AOC is.
Yep.
And they are both very smart, and they will put up with none of that bullshit.
None of it.
And that is why there has always been such an emphasis on trying to put them in their place. And that's what this was.
It was incredible. And there's other footage of Jasmine Crockett from yesterday telling, schooling somebody who's involved in Project 2025 as to, you know, how things should work, how things are the law. She is a rising star. She's great. This, I think she just had enough of Marge. Marge, I think there's no reining her in. Unfortunately, she'll win re-election, and she takes her cues directly from Trump. This not adhering to any norms, turning the House of Representatives into that, it's depressing. It's just really depressing.
You know, obviously, all of these people, like virtually everyone who went to New York, is auditioning yep. for Trump's reality TV show, and Marge still thinks, and she might be right, that she still thinks she can become his vice presidential nominee. And the you know, Trump frankly was quite impressed with Noam's dog killing story.
Oh God, that just horrific. Who can be the worst person in the world? New reality show. You know, the worst Republican can aspire to be Trump's running mate. Vacation. Marcy Wheeler, we're coming up to the end of the hour. I have to mention something that I just read on Shitter this morning. So we don't have an exclusive with you anymore. You're going to embark on a new podcast with LOL GOP.
Exclusive.
I know.
I've been doing a series. Like, we do the week's news,
yes, right? Yep.
What he and I are doing, and I had started a series, and he's like, I really want to find some way to pull this together and it's much more produced. Like,
oh, yes.
There's the first episode, and we've been, you know, talking back and forth. That was like 8 conversations worth
wow.
into half an hour. So, and the goal there is to tell a historic story of how, and I did this series, it's a series, like
right.
a historic series of how Trump trained the GOP to hate rule of law, how we got to the point where Alito is flying upside down flags and trying to find a way to give Trump immunity, how we got to a place where Marge and Matt Gaetz go to New York City and threaten a judge's daughter, how, you know, we've gotten to this place. I mean, there's yesterday, the Congress is trying to hold Merrick Garland in contempt because he won't give them Trump's video.
The recording of Biden's deposition, right?
Right.
And, you know, honestly, like, people know that I have my criticism of Merrick Garland, and I spend a lot of time debunking garbage about Merrick Garland. I think that before Merrick Garland, Chris Wray didn't protect investigative entities, didn't, you know, so he was giving stuff over to Congress. And it's been this kind of fire, like the entire Hunter Biden thing was a fire hose. Like, Hunter Biden was given none of the due process that somebody being investigated ever is.
Mm-hmm.
And he has no recourse until after he is found guilty. And that was done under Merrick Garland, but it was done because Chris Wray never stood up against these things, you know, going back 8 years. And it has upended DOJ. And so Merrick Garland, you know, said to Joe Biden, don't, you know, invoke executive privilege over this interview, because, you know, if this interview gets out, then Donald Trump, when he comes back in, will say, I'm not going to do an interview with you. It'll get released to Congress and made into campaign ads,
right,
which is,
right.
of course, what the Republicans wanted
of
to
course.
Do. And so Garland is not wrong, but it should have happened in 2018.
Mm-hmm.
It should have happened under Jeff Sessions. It should have happened under Chris Wray. And so it's putting that back together again is not going to be easy.
Wow. Well, so I'm a big fan of LOL GOPs. He's been on the show before, actually. I'm drawing a blank on his actual name, but he writes.
I don't even know whether I'm allowed to use his actual name.
He writes under at USA Today. Under his name.
It's Jason Sattler.
Jason Sattler, right. And he's been on this program before because I've read his stuff at USA Today and he's great. So this looks interesting. It's called Ball of Thread. You can subscribe you can go to Patreon. That's what I have up on the screen now. Is it at Ball of Thread? Well, you'll have the details at emptywheel.net.
Oh, geez. I will, but probably not. Because like I said, Masaccio is in town. I made creme brulee for the first time in decades. He doesn't know that yet. He's out of the burn, but I made creme brulee today. So that's what I have planned for tonight is to eat.
Enjoy.
Creme brulee.
Well, you know, I'm of the mind. Weekends are meant to just unplug and get away from this mess. You go enjoy your friends. I'm going to go listen to Michael Franti music and get an injection of positivity because I need it. And maybe on the ride up or back, I will listen to the first episode of the Ball of Thread podcast. You can get it at Patreon, Apple Podcasts, or Spotify. It's a nice balance between what we do here and what you'll do with the...
I mean, you'll see that intro episode sort of starts where we've been. It's like, I called him up after the SCOTUS and I'm like, this is the end point. Like that immunity hearing is where I'm trying to describe trajectory to, and then we'll go back. And then the next one, if I understand where he's going, is a post I did a long time ago about Paul Manafort and how Paul Manafort was in the business of stinking up the female opponent of Viktor Yanukovych, and that's what he was brought in for Trump. And then I'll start explaining what happened with the Russian investigation. And some of what I just said about the dossier will be one of the upcoming episodes.
Great. So again, I so look forward to it. Marcy Wheeler, you're a treasure. You're a national treasure, and I appreciate the work you do. And I'm glad, look, we are more informal here. That is going to be more produced and more centered on a theme. We'll do the week.
You want to hear about what happened in the week? Come here. If you want to hear about what happened in 2017, go there. But, you know, listen
to
both
of them. Do it all. There's plenty of time to listen. But take a weekend and unplug because it's insane. Marcy Wheeler, again, find her at emptywheel.net here on Fridays and with LOL GOP on the Ball of Thread podcast as well. Marcy, thank you so much. Thank you for accommodating me early today. I'm going to go unplug as soon as I post this thing.
I hope you have a wonderful weekend. I'm jealous. That's
I'll take pictures.
So
I'll take lots of pictures. I'll shit them out. All right. Thank you, Marcy. We'll talk next week.
Drive safely.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye. All right. And that's it. Have a great weekend, everyone. We'll see you next week. Peace out.